In this lesson, we'll focus on high availability throughout the Pi system, as well as on how we'll implement this on our hands-on virtual learning environment. We'll work on creating a highly available architecture, like the one shown here. There will be two Pi interface instances in failover, allowing for redundant data collectors. Each Pi interface node will also have the Pi buffer subsystem enabled, not only for its end-way buffering, but also to buffer data in case one of the Pi collective members goes down. The Pi data archives will form a Pi collective, creating redundancy for data access. And lastly, end users will be using Pi client applications built on the Pi SDK, which actively seeks to connect to available Pi collective members. A few more notes on Pi data archive replication. When a Pi collective is first formed, you designate one Pi data archive as the primary server. The rest are all secondary members, and they are essentially wiped out and then made to be identical with the primary server. This ensures that any existing time series data, as well as configuration settings, are the same across all members right from the birth of the Pi collective. After this point, there are two major categories of information that continually must be kept the same across all members. First, time series data. We already know that it's end-way buffering on the Pi interface nodes that help achieve data consistency across all members. So next, consider configuration settings, like Pi point attributes and Pi data archive security, that get edited on a member of the Pi collective. What mechanism will allow for this single change to get propagated to the rest of the members? Well, first note that users can change these type of settings only on the primary server. The Pi collective won't allow changes to be made on any secondary server. After a change is made, the primary member is responsible for syncing these changes so that the rest of the Pi collective members receive this update. This is all automatic and takes no effort on the user that makes the change. There are some parameters that are never replicated or synced though. These include tuning parameters, message logs, and Pi firewall settings. Tuning parameters are a subset of Pi data archive settings that are usually specific to the machine hosting the Pi data archive and are not appropriate to be replicated. Message logs too are inherent to its specific machine, and it doesn't make sense to sync across computers. Pi firewall is a built-in firewall that can allow or restrict certain IP addresses. These settings also shouldn't be synced since multiple Pi data archives could reside on different networks and not need the same firewall settings. Concerning some constraints, high availability within the Pi system works best when all the components, including the server-side software, as well as Pi interfaces and end users, are all contained within the same domain with a coherent structure, meaning a functioning domain controller with reliable DNS resolution. Also, note that there are some Pi system applications that cannot have its data buffered via the Pi buffer subsystem. The consequence of this is that its data won't go through end-way buffering and reach each member of a Pi collective. Rather, it gets sent to just a single server. These include performance equations, totalizer points, Pi batch generator, and any custom manual data entry application that doesn't use the Pi SDK. Some workarounds include using the Pi-to-Pi interface to send data from that single server to the other Pi collective members, or just making sure that any end user who needs this data strictly connects to that single server. In the next lesson, we'll start our first set of installations. But before that point, make sure to jot down the names of all your virtual learning environment machines and their roles. There are 5 computers in all. The computer whose name ends with Pi Serve 1 has a Pi data archive already installed. It has the Pi AF server installed as well. Soon, we will use this as the primary server in a Pi collective. Pi Serve 2 does not have any Pi System software installed yet. But this server will eventually become a member of a Pi collective with Pi Serve 1. Pi Int 1 has the Pi interface for OPC DA installed, while Pi Int 2 does not. This second server will eventually become Pi Int 1's pair for interface failover. Note, we won't be using the main controller machine for this course. In this video, we've completed the introduction to high availability for the Pi system, learning what's replicated during Pi collective formation, as well as how data and certain settings are made identical between all members after the Pi collective is created. We'll next work on what to check prior to installing a Pi data archive and then installing it.